Yes, it is the great I am who is listening and hearing what my children are saying to me. Be open to all that I will do in your life. Yes, hallelujah. It is I who is in your midst.
Hallelujah.
During a time of prayer, he had given me something else and he wants me to speak it. I want you to be open to my leadings and to act on what it is I ask you to do. Do not be distracted from what it is I would have you to do. Stay focused on me, the great I am.
Hallelujah. Good deal.
Stay close to me, my children. I will guide you into my truth and my way of doing things. Yield to me, the great I am. I am in your midst. I will never, no, never fail you.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Okay, one more.
Okay.
I long for my people to hear from the great I am constantly and to be willing and yield unto the King on high.
Praise the Lord. You guys ever see that movie Up?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yes.
Yeah.
Squirrel.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The word was don't get distracted, right? You ever saw it? The movie Up, it's a cartoon, and these dogs would be just chasing them down and they're about to get them and then one would go, squirrel! They all just stop in the middle of their passionate pursuit. And it's hilarious. That just for that, you should watch it. Yes. Pardon me?
Well, we have a testimony.
Forget it, baby. It's too late. Go ahead. Testify.
Okay. Yesterday we, God puts us in certain positions so that we can give opportunity, right? And that was the word that he'd given me yesterday. Yesterday we had gone down to the river, to go check it out, camping places, and we ended up at Fort Churchill. We were kind of tooling along, we had the AC on. Well, the car dies. Okay, so he turns it off and he starts it back up, we turn everything off, and the car continually is having issues. It's not one to run, it's just overheated. So we sit there for a few minutes. Well, Chris says, okay, Tammy, start praying. So I start praying, and I'm not speaking in a low voice. I am literally yelling, And we finally get up to a shade where we can sit with the dogs. Well, I'm sitting there, after praying, and God goes, this is an opportunity. This is not a problem. And we weren't stressed. We were calm, So anyway, I go, honey, this is an opportunity for us. This is God's got his hand in this somehow. And that's something that, not only opportunity, but we have to continually look around and see, instead of looking at the negative side of it, the car's broke down, we're going to freak out. No, we have to look at the opportunities that God's going to give us and put us in to speak to other people. Well, lo and behold, I told him this. And he, about opportunity, this is just an opportunity for us. We don't know how or why, but God's going to do it. So we're sitting there, and a truck comes in, one of the state park guys, or gal, and she went over to the office, and we're sitting there, and so Chris walks over there, because my phone is on, just dying. I've got 6%, So, he goes over there and he talks to her, and then she comes over and she talks to us, and we're kind of just talking, and we got the feeling that, in our spirit we needed to keep her lifted up in prayer. Nothing was really said, but God put us in her life for a reason, so we prayed for her. Well, then we got the car going, praise the Lord, he was answering prayer. We got on the road, we headed up towards Silver Springs, got up on the hill, the car died again. Now we're sitting on top of the hill. Chris was trying to get to a place where I would have telephone service, let alone my phone was barely on, At one point we had to call Wes. So we called Wes, and I had 6% on my phone. Now where we were at, there's no way we could ever get reception. him on his phone either. I mean, he didn't even take his phone. So we get up there, and the officer stops, and she comes over, asks if we need help or anything, and he told her, we don't have service, and so she said, we'll call dispatch. So they called dispatch and got a hold of Wes. He said, I'll be there in 15, 20 minutes.
Praise the Lord.
So anyway, long story short, we got to pray because we started talking with the officer. You know, she didn't really want to leave us. It was God. She didn't want to leave us up there on that hill with cars zipping by, you know. I was scared. And so we had the opportunity, Chris had the opportunity, both of us, to pray with her. She couldn't hold his hand, you know, but she let us pray with her, you know, because she's, you know, that's an official that we should be proud of, you know, because they do protect us, even though what's going on in the world. So we had a chance to talk with her and pray with her. And we knew that God had placed us in those two positions to have opportunity to pray for somebody. You know, and I just thought that was just really cool. Instead of looking at, oh, the car broke down, we had to call Wes, you know, the thing was opportunity to pray with these people and keep them lifted up in our prayers, you know?
Hallelujah.
Opportunity. And we have to watch for those things.
Gotta watch for opportunities. Amen. So turn with me to Matthew 25, please. We'll have an opportunity to get into the Word. Matthew, the 21st, 5th chapter.
21st?
5th. 25th. 25, 25. We're going to start up in about 22. 14. You get all that? Okay, Matthew 25, the 14th verse, we're going to pray. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you that you've stirred us up to take hold of you. And Lord, we submit to you right now. We function according to the government of God. And we thank you, Jesus, you are the head. And we function as you are the head. And we thank you, God. Take your word, penetrate our hearts today. In Jesus' name, amen. 25:14 says, for the kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling to a far country who called his own servants and delivered his goods to them. So who is he talking about? His own servants. He's talking about children of the king. To one he gave 5 talents, to another he gave 2 talents, to another he gave 1, and each according to his own ability. And immediately he went in on his journey. Now according to their own ability. You notice the guy that got 1 was according to his own ability. God will give us what we are able to steward. Okay, he will not give you above what you are able to steward. He will give you what you are able to steward. So if the guy next to you has more than you, don't get weirded out about it. We're not here for comparison. We're here to function with what God has given us, each one, and to function in that. So let's go on just a little bit. And likewise, then he who received the 5 talents went and traded them and made another 5 talents. And likewise, he who had received 2 gained 2 more also, but he who had received 1 went, dug in the ground, hid the Lord's money. After a long time, the Lord of those servants came to settle accounts. You notice this, the giver of the gift is coming to settle accounts. You notice he just doesn't give gifts. He comes to settle accounts and find out what you did with the gift he gave you.
Yes.
Okay? He understands. Yes, he expects fruit. He doesn't just give you stuff just so you can have it. Okay? So he who had received the 5 talents came and bought 5 other talents, saying, look, Lord, you delivered me 5, I got 10 more. The Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things. I make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of the Lord. Now you notice he doesn't just say, well done, good and faithful servant. He says, I'm going to make you ruler over many things because you were faithful in the few I gave you. So God is a God of reward, and he just doesn't reward you with standing on a cloud in heaven playing a harp, unless that's what you really like to do. He rewards you with adventure and challenge and opportunities to serve and opportunities to command and opportunities to rule. It's a wonderful thing. God is a great... And then he says, enter into the joy of the Lord. One guy said, Well, if I'm to enter into the joy of the Lord and I'm supposed to be happy in heaven, what makes me happy is golf, so there must be golf in heaven. And another guy said, no, there can't be. He says, there will be no weeping and gnashing of teeth in heaven. If you've ever played golf, okay, if you haven't, just don't worry about it, okay. He also had received two talents, came to him, the Lord said, you delivered me two, I gained two more besides them. And he said, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in a few things, I make you rule over many things. Enter into the joy of the Lord. Same principle applies. Then the one who had received one talent came to him and said, Lord, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. And I was afraid and went and hid your talent in the ground. Look, there you have what is yours. But his Lord answered him and said, you wicked and lazy servant. You knew that, etc., etc. It says, therefore, take that talent from him, give it to him who has 10. To everyone who has, more will be given to him. He will have an abundance. But to him who does not have, even what he has will be taken away from him. And you notice, the thing that he didn't have was gain. He didn't have any fruit from what he gave. He still had the talent, but he said, he who doesn't have anything, in other words, he who didn't use what I gave him, is not going to enter into the joy of the Lord. It is a wickedness and a sin to not use the potential God has given you.
That's right.
If we just waste away. Now, I got this word from the Lord early in the week, to squander. I didn't even know what squander meant. It's kind of like a swear word, squander. You know. And so I went and looked it up, and it means to waste stuff, okay? Or use it, just to waste it. And I realized things we can waste, okay? We can waste talent.
Yes.
And I wrote down here two people, Elvis and Chris. You know, I compare them because they're both musicians, right? Elvis was a powerfully gifted musician. And what did he use it for? He used it basically for his own glory. Okay, he sang really good gospel songs. He really did, and he had an anointing on him. But listen, he died a drug addict.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, he didn't die this famous, wonderful king of rock and roll. He died a drug addict, okay? It was a waste of his talent. He wasted it away. Now, Chris, on the other hand, used to be a rock and roll guy, being as stupid as Elvis was being. But he decided that one day God got a hold of him, and now he's using his talent to glorify God. He's still in the places, he went back to the places that he used to go, but now he uses what God has given him as a platform to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ, and people are coming to the Lord. We had a rededication of his marriage the other day, and there were all kinds of people there. And these people were... Okay, it's all right. Yeah, and they were... Anyway, they were changed by the effect that he and Tammy had in their lives.
Amen.
They were changed by that. Amen. And what magnitude that makes in the scheme of things, you have no idea what potential you have even in God. You don't have any idea. And he just has a little idea of the potential he has, and he's using what he has. So as we step out in faith, believing that God, what else can we squander? Our money.
Yep.
We can squander our money. You know, I can't tell you how many people are squandering their money, but J.C. Penney, at the end of his life, was giving away 95% of his money. R.C. Letourneau, the guy that made the great big cranes and stuff, that 500,000 tons, and dump it in a truck that holds 500,000 tons of stuff, he made those things. He ended up giving away 95% of his money at the end of his life. Now, what is 5% of 5 billion.
Yeah.
The guy wasn't living bad.
Yeah.
These guys weren't stupid people. You know, some people, well, sell your business. Come on, you got to pay the bills, you got to do stuff. It doesn't mean be ridiculous, it just means step out in faith. Okay? God doesn't say, go ye be ridiculous. It's like the girl who's going to marry the guy, she was 14, he was 52. He was married, he was in prison for rape, and she wants to marry him. and came to the minister, and the minister says, thou shalt not be ridiculous. Okay? Okay? When God is sending you some, that calling will bring with it the provision God has for you. And sometimes that provision is just you to stay where you're at for a while and make yourself built up to a place where you can do the things you need to do. Praise the Lord. So if you're if God is calling you for something, keep your day job and look to those things. Scout it out. Look for it. I know a lot of people just quit their jobs and now they're without anything. And they're traveling around. Well, I'm just doing the calling of the Lord. Anyway. Some of them are. There was one out of the 500 that I picked up as a hitchhiker. One was doing the will of the Lord. One of them. The rest were just traveling around sucking off churches. That's what they were doing. Okay? So, one out of 500. It's not bad, I guess. All right. A talent, I read this today, and I've heard different amounts, but a talent is worth 15 years' wages. Wow. So what the giver of the gift was giving them was an extravagant amount. And I wrote down here, how much does 5 talents add up to? That's 45 years' wages.
Wow.
Extravagant amount. And what is the guy who got the 5 talents? What's he do? It says in a different gospel, it says immediately he went and invested that money. He didn't wait. He obeyed God right away. He went and invested what God had given him right then because he understood the gift.
Yeah.
And he understood the giver. He was a hard man, reaping where he had not planted, etc. And he was afraid too. What he was afraid to do is not invest what his Lord had given him. What the guy with the one talent was afraid to do was invest what the Lord had given him. The one guy got it, the other guy didn't get it. Okay? Some of us in this place have got stuff from God and we just are squandering it away. Okay? I wrote down here, well, I just didn't realize the time. I talked about talent and money. The thing you can squander the most, you can reestablish your talent. You can make more money. But when you squander your time, you're spending something you'll never get back. And I don't know about you, but the Americans that I know, they squander more time than anything else. They squander their time. It's like having a roll of bills that big, and that's all you got for the rest of your life. And they're just spending that time, just spending it like that. What potential are we wasting, okay? In front of the television, in front of the computer, in front of whatever your thing is, the phone or whatever. You know, we can waste our time. Now, some of you have ministry online. That's a great thing. Me, I'm not an online guy. So I don't online anything. I get online once in a while to get Tony's jokes. And that's about it. And some of Jim's stories and stuff. But I just don't, I'm just not that guy. If you want to get a hold of me, call me. Or text me. I know how to text. A 9-year-old taught me to text. I swear. She said, I'm going to teach you to text. And I said, all right. And so every day she texts me. And so I said, being a man of my word, you know, I said, okay, I'll text you back, you know. Being a man of my word, I am trying to figure out how to make letters out of numbers. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3.
Oh,
1, 2.
No.
1, 1, 2, 3. What is that? It took me 20 minutes to get the first text out. Oh. Then I got one of those sideways phones.
Uh-oh.
I can type okay, but that number thing freaked me out. All right. So we can squander our money, all right? We can squander all kinds of things. We can squander our children. I just wrote this as a sideline. It's like the AAA. I heard this on the radio. It's like the AAA guy. Okay, one of the things we can do for our children is affirm them. And I talked about affirmation in this place last week, about affirming something that you believe until God confirms it in your life.
Yeah.
Okay, you affirm that thing. Also, you can affirm your children. And an affirmation is an acknowledgement, an utterance, a statement, a voice. It's a testimony. You can affirm them. And the way you affirm them is with your voice. You know, you just don't come up. Anyway, you affirm them. Man, you are the, you know, if I had everybody to choose from in this world, I would have choose you as a grandson. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I heard that on the radio. Now listen to this. I heard that on the radio, and I'm over at Lowe's, and Jaden has this little thing. For an hour, he goes over there and he makes this little thing with a hammer about that long. God knows how do you pound a nail with a hammer? That and he's hitting that baby, and he pounded all the nails, and only one bent this time. Okay? And I was sitting there and I thought about what that guy had told me. And I says, Jaden, you know, we see all these kids in here? He says, yeah. I said, if I had every one of them to choose from, I'd choose you as my grandson.
Aww.
And he, and it freaks me out right now. And he just looked at me and says, really? So I practiced with, and it was awesome. I thought, Grace, that was really cool, man. And another thing we can do for our children, or these are friends too. Don't get me wrong, or your spouse, or whomever is okay, we can appreciate them. And tell them you appreciate them. And tell them you appreciate what they're doing and where they're going. And how that tattoo on their back that says honor, integrity, and stuff like that is better than Lula. Oh, whatever, you know. I know a guy, his mother got mad at him for getting a tattoo on his back, but when she saw what he got, he was going in the army, and it was honor, integrity, faith, courage, stuff like that, tattooed on his back. Dang, I thought, you must be the proudest mother on the face of the earth. To have your kid put that on his back? That's how she just looked at me and went, to this day, she loves it. She loves that thing. I'm telling you, those parents, every one of their kids is serving the Lord in some capacity, and every one of them is serving people in some capacity. When you see that in a family where they're raised up to serve, mm-hmm. and they're serving somebody in some capacity, it's just an awesome thing. Okay. And it comes from a parent's affirmation and appreciation of their child. And the other third A is affection. However old they are, get down. If you have a two-year-old, get down to the two-year-old's level. I don't care how bad your knees are. You don't get down there some way and say, hi, sweetheart. My knees are kind of bad, but I just thought I'd say hi. I taught 2 and 3-year-olds for 4 years. I'm telling you what, you get down in their level and they look at you and go, I mean, you're up here, they could care less. They see your knees.
Yeah.
They got good-looking knees, you know. They don't care. They don't, like this. Boy, you get down their level, and they're listening to you. Mm-hmm. They got their eyes that big around. It's just something you can do for them. And touch them. Touch your kids, or they're going to crave that touch from somebody else.
Mm-hmm.
And I know we don't have a lot of young couples in here. And I want you to know that I get my hands on my kids. Floyd is tough. It's like hugging a 2x12. But he, you know, he's lovinger than he used to be because I just keep touching him. And John, I get a hold of him like this. How you doing, John? He's bigger. Praise the Lord. So that was just a sideline I thought I'd throw in. Okay. So this one who gave the gift to you, this gift of eternal life, these things he's placed in you, this destiny, he's coming back to settle accounts with you. Okay? Have you ever tried to finesse your way out of a traffic ticket? Okay, just thought I'd mention that because when Jesus comes back to settle accounts with you, you're not going to be able to finesse your way out of, well, Lord, remember that thing I mentioned the other day, the when-then thing? When I get enough money, then I'll serve you.
Oh.
When I get enough time, then I'll affirm my children. When I... Then that's when and thing doesn't work. Okay. And by the way, he's not going to ask you what you did with what you didn't have. He's going to ask you what did you do with what you had. Okay. Now I wrote down here. I think we can control part of this. Okay. And with affirmation of ourselves and whomever, we can control part of this process, because I've been quoting Psalm 45:7 and Hebrews 1:9, and says, and you anointed him with the oil of joy above his fellows because you hated evil and loved righteousness. And I've been, because there are some areas in my life where I was loving wickedness.
loving evil. And I didn't realize it, and I realized when you start loving righteousness, it automatically puts this hate against evil in you. And what happens when you start loving righteousness, hating evil? All of a sudden you have this joy, this oil of joy inside of you above your fellows. Why? Because you love righteousness and hate wickedness. If God did it for Jesus Christ, by God, He'll do it for me. If I just move into this place where Jesus was in loving righteousness. Now, He says, they who hunger and thirst after righteousness, they shall be filled. Filled with what? I guess with joy and with righteousness, by the way. But I just don't do things right all the time. Of course I do. Okay, if you're feeling a little challenged by that statement, loving righteousness and hating wickedness, I want you to know it is a process. This is a journey we are on. It's not some arrival into righteousness where I just hate wickedness all the time. No. You need to practice hating evil and loving righteousness. You need to practice loving the sinner and hating the sin. You need to practice loving the righteousness, not comparing yourself to somebody else. It's a practice thing. This is more of an art than a science.
That's right.
You move into stuff, okay? In Hebrews 11:2, I got it marked back here, I think. Yeah, back here. No, that's Philippians. What does Hebrews 11:2 say? I'll get there for you anyway, never mind. Hebrews 11:2 says, Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things unseen. For by it the elders obtained a good testimony. A good testimony. Now I want to read to you a testimony, I think. Yeah. This is just a little short testimony. You guys like stories?
Yes.
I couldn't tell this whole thing, so I just thought I'd just read part of it, okay? The Spirit began, This guy is talking to a guy on an airplane. The guy's all dressed in a suit. This pastor, he's been dressed in a suit all week, so he dresses down, he gets in his Levi's and stuff, and he's on the plane. He gets next to this guy. The guy's carrying a briefcase. He's all a Wall Street-looking dude, okay? The Spirit began, and he says, looking skeptically at Connor's clothing, our MBA, I don't know what that means, asked about his line of work. Then Connor... I'll let Cotter tell it from here. So this is, he was feeling intimidated sitting next to this very successful man. He says, the Spirit began to brood over the face of the deep. Order and power emerged from chaos. A voice in a whisper reminded me, let him who boasts, boast in the Lord. So he started saying, it's interesting that we have a similar business interest, I said. You are in the body changing business. This guy was changing women's appearances so they'd have more self-esteem, okay? The body-changing business, I'm in a personality-changing business. We apply basic theocratic principles to accomplish indigenous personality modification. He was hooked, but I knew he would never admit it. Pride, okay. You know, I've heard of that, he replied hesitantly. But do you have an office here in the city? Oh, we have office in many places. We have offices up and down the state. In fact, we're national. We have at least one office in every state in the union, including Alaska and Hawaii. He had this puzzled look on his face. He was searching his mind to identify this huge company he must have read about or heard about, perhaps in the Wall Street Journal, because he was reading one. As a matter of fact, we have gone international. The management has a plan to put at least one office in every country in the world by the end of the business era. I paused. Do you have that in your business? Well, no, not yet, he answered. But you mentioned management. How do they make it work? It's a family concern. There's a father and a son, and they run everything. Must be a lot of capital, he asked skeptically. Oh, you mean money? I asked. Yes, I suppose so. No one knows just how much it takes, but we never worry about because there's never a shortage. The boss always seems to have enough, and he's a very creative guy. And the money is, well, it's just there. In fact, those of us in the organization have a saying about our boss. He owns a cattle on 1,000 hills. Oh, he's into ranching. No, it's just a saying that we use to indicate his wealth. My friend sat back in his seat. What about with you? The employees. They're something to see, I said. They have a spirit that pervades the organization. It works like this. The father and son love each other so much that their love filters down through the organization so that we all find ourselves loving one another too. I know that sounds old-fashioned in a world like ours, but I have people in the organization who are willing to die for me. Do you have that in your business?
Wow.
I was almost shouting by now. People were starting to shift noticeably in their seats. Not yet, he said, quickly changing strategies. He said, but do you have good benefits? Set up. Oh, okay. They're substantial, I countered with a gleam in my eye. I have complete life insurance. Fire insurance, all the basics. You might not believe this, but it's true. I have holdings in a mansion that's being built for me right now for my retirement. Do you have that in your business? Not yet, he answered wistfully. The light was dawning. You know, one thing bothers me. I've read journals, and if your business is as all as you say it is, why haven't I heard about it before now? That's a good question, I said. After all, we have a 2,000-year-old tradition. Want to sign up?
Wow. Isn't that cool?
That's cool.
So what started out as an intimidation for him, something that was going to hinder his testimony, turned into an opportunity as he stepped out in faith. Every time you have an opportunity, sometimes there's fear involved, sometimes there's trepidation involved, sometimes there's risk involved, very many times. But every time you step out in faith, God will meet you after that first step and just fill you with all kinds of cool things to say. In fact, I've talked to people before. I wish I was taking notes. Because I said to myself, man, if I could remember to say it like this every time, everybody gets saved. You ever been like that? I mean, the Holy Spirit just fills you with cool things to say. Other times, you'll stumble over stuff. You'll try to get stuff out. Nothing will come out right. And the person, tears will be coming into their eyes as they ask if they can get saved. You'll just be going. In other words, it's not you. It's the Spirit of God that works in us, both to will and to do of His good pleasure. Okay. So then, okay. In Romans 8:18, if you're looking for benefits, it says there, the things we suffer now are nothing to be compared with that of the benefits that will be revealed in us when He comes. It's not even to be compared. So as we begin to compare ourselves, okay, fullness, adventure, rest, creativity, fruitfulness, what do you find your joy in? I wrote down here, maybe something needs to change.
Yes.
What do you find your joy in? Well, I find my joy in golf. Well, maybe something needs to change. If your joy comes from this temporal world, it can be taken away from you.
Mm-hmm.
If your joy comes from being in shape, okay? I want you to know, from now on, you're going to sag and bag.
Yeah.
That's what happens. When I was running 15 miles a day, it was my joy. I lived to run. I'd run 15 miles in the morning about 5 at night, or 5 in the morning about 10 at night. And I just loved running. That's what I lived to do every day. Winter, summer, didn't matter. And one day, I hurt myself, and I couldn't run for quite a long time. And I got sick and all kinds of things. And God was dealing with me to live by faith and not by what I felt or saw or anything like that. And so I began to live my life by faith. And I got to where I was happy not being in shape. Now, I figured out ways to stay in shape, because when I became a preacher, I had been a carpenter for 30 years. I was fairly strong, I was lifting weights all the time. And I became a pastor, so I'd sit down and I'd study, and I'd sit down and I'd counsel, and I'd go to the hospitals and I'd drive there and sit there and talk to people. And so one day, I was walking along and I bumped into a door jamb, and it hurt. I'm serious, it's what happened to me. And I bumped into that door jamb and it hurt, and I thought, jeepers, creepers, man, I better do something. And then next week, a 12-year-old came up to me and punched me in the stomach like that. And that about knocked the air out of me. I thought, man, I better start doing some sit-ups. And so I went back to start getting a little bit of better shape. So anyway, we got to keep ourselves going. Okay.
We're supposed to keep our temple healthy. That's right.
Now, this is a temple of the Holy Ghost. I might as well, you know.
Take care of it?
Yeah. If I thought I was going to live this long, I would have took a lot better care of myself. Okay. We had Gary Short, the old pastor, he had a saying back when he was a kid. He says, live hard, die young, leave a good-looking corpse. In the Revelation, it says, to him who overcomes, I will grant him to sit with me on my throne like my Father has granted me to sit on his throne. What are you living for? To sit on your throne here, to sit on your throne there. Okay. All right, a penny, just a penny for your thoughts. It's all those were worth, that's right. Okay, in Philippians, these guys. Of course, I knew exactly what you're thinking, so what does that say about me? All right. Philippians 2, in the fifth verse, it says this. Let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus, who being in the very form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself, became obedient to the point of death, even the death on the cross. Therefore, okay, Jesus Christ learned obedience through the things he suffered. So what does suffering look like to you? Yesterday, Regina had misplaced her debit card. And I'm not going to go through all the details of that, but she misplaced her debit card, and I want you to know that that was suffering for her. Okay? So if the suffering brings about obedience, I asked her, what is the obedience that God is training you in this? How is God trying to love you through this? Where's God in this deal? If this is suffering for you, he learned obedience to the things he suffered. If Jesus Christ learned obedience to the things he suffered, so do I. So what's suffering to you? When I lose my wallet, I suffer. You know, I don't want to lose. I misplaced my keys. That's suffering. These are just little things. Some of you have terrible, awful suffering and things like that. We just buried Wendy Tustin yesterday. God bless her. He went through all kinds of suffering, just years of it. And each one of those things, and the way Pastor Joe was talking, I mean, she learned wonderful things from what she suffered through. So, anyway, let's just keep going here, okay? Let this mind be in you. Therefore, God, now watch this, what happened? That the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, those in heaven, those on earth, and those under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Are you a child of God?
Yes.
Yes. So you, just being in the form of a child of God, consider it not something to be held on to, but make yourself a servant, and guess what? You'll get a therefore too, also. Okay. 12 and 13 says this, therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not in my presence only, but much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Why? For it is God who works in you both the will and to do of his good pleasure. As for Jesus, so for you. That's what it says. Okay. You want to argue with the Bible, go ahead. Me, not going to do that. So I wrote down here, but what difference can I make? Through my obedience or through the things that I step out in faith, what difference can I make? Okay. Let me jump down here. Yeah. I gotta read this part. Moses, okay? God said to Moses, go down there to Pharaoh, the most powerful man on earth, and tell him to let his labor force go to worship a God that he doesn't believe in. And go to a people and convince them, this broken and stiff-necked people, to run away into the desert. Moses, this is your calling. And what does Moses say? Lord, here I am. Send Aaron. I had to throw that in just in case God is calling you to something beyond yourself. Okay? So in Ephesians 5:16 it says, walk circumspectly, okay? Redeeming the time, for the days are evil. Okay? He says, not as fools. Okay, and I talked about the 14-year-old who's going to marry the 56-year-old cement worker who was in jail for rape and was married already. Okay. Okay, walk circumspectly. Don't be an idiot. Okay? God still speaks. Jesus still commands, come. God is calling me to work in missions. Okay? What have you got to offer to that mission? What are you doing now to prepare yourself for that mission? If God is calling you to something, how are you preparing for that? Well, I'm 80 years old. Okay, how are you preparing for what God has called you to do? What are you doing with that calling? Well, I'm only 14. Okay, I know a guy named, can't remember his name. He got called to the missions at 15. He went through high school. He didn't do football because he thought he'd get injured, but he wrestled so he could get in shape to be strong for the mission field. He went on to the mission field. They established a camp. They went into Ecuador. They got all established, and they flew over the camp, and it took them years to do this stuff. Years of study and years of planning, and they were flying over that place, and finally they landed in Ecuador on the river where this indigenous people was, and when they landed, the people that they were going to minister to killed them all. Speared them to death. Okay? Years of preparation, staying in shape, going through high school. Was it wasted? God never wastes potential, and He never wastes faith. Those very men's wives were back in the camp. They were the ones that finally got into Ecuador to minister to these people. And because their husbands have given their lives, they realized these were their wives, and they were able to lead those people to Christ. Yeah. Two generations later, there's one of those guys in that indigenous tribe in Ecuador that takes an ultralight glider with the little, the hang glider, and he flies in supplies into the deep jungle to minister to people down in the deep jungle and preach the gospel.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Two generations later, did what they did in high school matter? Yes! Yes, they would have never have done it otherwise. We have no idea what the potential is for us. Look at Chuck Colson. He said, the real legacy of my life was my biggest failure. If you guys don't know Chuck Colson, Nixon, Watergate, went to jail. He was in jail, saw the prisoners who were in need, began to minister. Prison fellowship came out of this, okay? Mike Morrissey over here just lost his job. We've met with him 2 weeks now since he's lost his job. He's so excited he can barely stand it. They fired him for doing something right, okay? Okay, all right, let's keep going here just a bit. Where are those names I wrote down? Oh, yeah. Boy, I have a lot of stuff here. Okay. Sorry. Okay. Sometimes frustration will launch you into your calling. Okay? There's a girl named Harriet Mears saw that her study group didn't have an introduction to the Bible in one volume that was solid enough for them to begin to learn the Bible, so she wrote one. And she published it. And she created her own publishing company called Gospel Light. Ever heard of Gospel Light? You've been a Christian for as long as I have, you heard of it. Okay? She also saw that there is a need for the ministers to go to a beautiful place on retreats to be ministered unto. So she saw a place, and she began to talk to the guy, and now that's called Forest Home, and it houses all kinds of missionaries and people that go there for conferences. She also, on it goes in her life. Another guy named Toby, okay? He went on a little mission trip to Ethiopia. While he was there on this mission trip to Ethiopia, a little kid came up to him, a kid about his size, and they looked at one another, and he had this really nice t-shirt on, said something about Jesus, you know? And the kid had this old tore-up thing, and they're like face to face. And he looked at him, and the kid looked him up and down like that, and he looked at himself and says, "Can I have your t-shirt?" And he was going to spend all day in that hot, beating sun without a t-shirt, so he just shrugged and got on the bus. I know you would have gave your t-shirt away. But this kid, Toby, it got to him. Started really eating at him. So he decided that he was going to get some t-shirts to send over to Ethiopia. So he began to go in his hometown and get them. Somebody heard about it, got on the radio, and he got 10,000 t-shirts. Now they weighed 2 tons. Now he's got to send these 2,000 t-shirts over to Africa somewhere. So he went, tried to get nobody to go, and finally he found an outfit that was going over there, but they're only going to one country. What country do you think they're going to? Ethiopia. So he got these 2 tons of t-shirts over there, dropped them off, and who knows if that kid got a t-shirt, but he knows that God called him to do that. Okay? So, and there's another thing. So compassion can compel you into your calling. Frustration can compel you into your calling, and prayer can go, okay? There's a guy named Doug Coe, ministers in D.C. A kid named Bob came to him one time, and he was wondering what he could do. Because he couldn't do anything else. The guy says, why don't you pray? He says, all right. He says, I want you to pray for something for a month. He says, okay, I'm going to pray for Africa. He says, okay, can you narrow it down? He says, yeah, pray for Kenya. He says, okay, I'll make you a deal. I'll give you $500 if you pray for Kenya every day for a month. And if nothing substantial happens, I'll give you the $500. If prayer isn't answered, I'll give you $500. So he was had integrity, so he began to pray for Kenya every day. Okay? So as he was praying, he went to a couple conferences there in Washington, D.C., sitting next to a woman who began to talk about Kenya. And what the guy said, he could see that $500 taking wing. Okay? So he began to ask her about stuff, and so she says, do you want to come to Kenya? He says, yeah. So he saved up money, went to Kenya. He was over there and realized he didn't have any pharmaceuticals. So he came back to the States and started getting to them, so he started calling pharmacies. And what happened is he collected $1 million worth of pharmaceuticals and got them sent over to Kenya, Africa, okay? He got all this done, so this lady says, hey, do you want to come to Kenya again and see what you've done? So he went over there, and the president of Kenya just happened to be in the orphanage that he sent the pharmaceuticals to, and they met with them, and as they were talking to the president, as they were touring the country, he says, what are those guys, that prison there? He says, those are political prisoners. And the kid said, well, that's a bad idea. You should let them go. That's all he said. Just a kid from the United States, went to Kenya, did this stuff. And lo and behold, he got back to the United States, and a couple weeks later, I think it was, the Secretary of State or somebody like that says, is this Bob? I said, yeah, this is Bob. Were you in Kenya lately? Yeah. Did you talk to the president? Yeah. He says, well, we want to meet with you because we've been trying to get our political prisoners released for about 2 years. And we found out that the president just let them go. Just because some kid says that's a bad idea, you ought to let them go. You see the potential? I read these things not to frustrate you or get you weirded out about what somebody else can do, but to inspire you to just step out in faith and do with what you have what God has called you to do and get a passion in your heart for something. And I want you to know there are lost people in our city. There are lost people here. And if we can do nothing else, we can pray and lead people to Christ. Just talk to them about the Savior. Will it cost you something? Might cost you your coolness. That's true. It might cost you your coolness. I want you to know you weren't that cool anyway. Okay? Might cost you your reputation. Thank God. I know some of you reputation guys, okay? Because you are a child of God. You have a destiny, okay? God is working in you both the will and to do of His good pleasure. So trying and failing and trying again is better than never trying at all. So in the next couple weeks, you're going to have opportunities to do something. You're going to have opportunities to enter into your calling in God. You are. You're going to have opportunities. I want you to know, if you wake up every day and ask God, Lord, show me when the opportunity arises. Just show me when the opportunity arises. Just keep praying those prayers every day. And Lord, give me opportunity. I need an opportunity. No opportunity is coming my way. Just show me. And then God will do that. It might be led by frustration. If you get frustrated, just say, I never get frustrated, so it doesn't really matter to me. Compassion. maybe I, anyway. Compassion, you might be led by compassion. If something stirs you deep on the inside, maybe you're supposed to get involved with that thing. Okay? And then prayer. Start praying about one thing every day for a month. One person every day for a month. Just these are just things to consider. I'm just giving you ideas. I'm just throwing these things out. So you'll, because every one of these things is biblical. I probably quoted 20, 30 scriptures today. Okay? So, and by the way, I quoted them to me too. Okay? So the people I'm hanging around are going to call me to hoil on this stuff. I live with a Christian woman. Sometimes it just,
you know? Careful.
Yeah, okay. Sometimes, you know, you just wish you were living around a heathen. You know, so you could just go ahead and walk through your day without thinking. No, you are children of God. You are in a different kingdom now. You really do have a destiny. So we can go ahead and choose the stuff. And by the way, I was serious about the cooler. We have a lot better cooler in the back. We just need the ducting run up. Okay? We'll buy the parts. If you're a sheet metal guy, and I don't know if you know a sheet metal guy or somebody like that. Otherwise, we've had it out there for about a year. It's apparent I'm not going to get to it. Okay? And I don't want a half-baked job. Seriously, don't just go out there and say, oh, I just want to do this for you, Matt. I don't want you to just do this for me. I want it done right so it looks good, so it's really professionally done, and so it's stuck in there right. Okay? The ducting from here out this way is all in. All you have to do is stick it in the hole.
Matt?
Yeah.
Talking about cooling, I had gone and checked out a cooler for my place. Uh-huh. A swamp cooler.
Uh-huh.
And they said, well, the one that you're looking at isn't going to be sufficient. You need to get a bigger one.
Uh-huh.
Okay, the person that was going to install the cooler, he says, you don't want that one, it will blow you away. So I got the smaller one and it is sufficient.
Praise the Lord.
What right. I'm saying to you is, I'm hoping that one doesn't blow you away. That you wanted, I mean, if you said it's so efficient.
It's okay. We have a thing called low and high.
We just want
the potential of freezing. Okay? We're looking for potential here. Huh? You can always wear a suit to church. Get that, the Pentecostal thing, you know? Get the neck up to here and the skirts down to there and the sleeves down to the end and everybody's sweating and, you know. You see T.D. Jakes? They keep the heat on in there. Just so you sweat. No, not really. He just jumps around a lot, man. You ever see him take off his shirt? That's a groovy, he wears groovy suits. Really does. And he takes out, and he's got like dark blue arms. Oh no, he had a dark blue shirt with white arms. Very cool. I like to dress like him. Anyway. But he was just soaking wet. And he's got a towel. And he just wipes off his head, you know, and gets all sweaty. I'm thinking, I have never done that, Lord. I need to jump around more. Of course, he's got an organ player in the back. It helps. Whee! Sorry. I really like DDJ. Anyway, Lord, I thank you for your word. I thank you that it goes forth and changes our lives. And God, we are the people who are taking the city for Christ. And I thank you for it, Lord, right now. And we want to be in on the deal. You've already given it to us. We want to be in on the deal. So show us our part this week. In Jesus' name, amen. Oh, thank you. By the way, I told you last week, right? I was up on the hill praying over our city. And I was crying out to God for it. And I said, God, this is your city. And God spoke right back to me. He says, no, this is your city. You get that? He spoke right to me. His Holy Spirit spoke right to me. This is your city. Amen. Freaked me out. Now there's responsibility involved.
Yeah. Oh, no. Amen.
Lord, we thank you for allowing us to give. Because God, this city has potential. And we as a people have potential. And you increase it all the time. You increase our resources so we're able to reach out even more. We thank you for the outreaches we have already, Lord. And we thank you for blessing them. And we thank you, Lord, for increasing us so we can do that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Bless it. Okay. We're meeting this evening right here. Do some rock and roll, some Bible study. Pardon me? 6 o'clock tonight. Yep. Can you imagine if each one of us in here led one person to Christ this week? And you're sitting across the aisle from somebody you led to Christ, took out of darkness and into light. Can you imagine that? That just freaks me out. I mean, you'd look over at him and go, wouldn't you? See, you just look up at the, you know, you go, hey, devil, I robbed from you.
No.
Amen. Remember that guy who woke up in the morning? Chafin was his name. Woke up, stood up in his bed every morning. Devil, I'm awake. I want you to know I'm taking back from you what you stole from God. I'm coming to get souls out of darkness today. Hallelujah. Jesus Christ is on me. He just started preaching it. He woke up one morning. His wife was there staring at him. And she caught him right before he stood up. And she says, not this morning, honey. Not this morning. You got to do what you got to do. So God bless you all. Have a wonderful day.